Thank you. First of all, thank you for allowing me to be on the stage for the fourth time. Before I start with my talk, I want to give a little bit of background information. Some of you might know that I like role-playing games. Some of you are in my class currently making their own role-playing games. And I create role-playing games for quite some time. And that's when I thought, redefining art, I want to say something about this from my perspective as a game creator. And that's why I chose this topic, redefining arts in role-playing games. Before we start, for all those people who don't know role-playing games, a little quick, incomplete history. Role-playing games started with war games. The idea was we have a big map, we have our armies, and we try to find the best way how these armies could find each other. Out of this tradition came the idea, what if it's not armies? What if it's individuals who are on a quest on that map? And we have in the first role-playing games more or less the same design language as in those war games. We measure distances with a ruler. And over time, we started standardizing. We have numerical values that decided how our characters or our roles are represented. But then there were shifts in the idea of role-playing games. Some games started to replace numerical values with moves or actions that are more narrative-rooted, and that made a shift from randomizers' dice to negotiation at the table. So we could look at this as a first redefinition of role-playing games in itself. But when we think about art, we can look at role-playing games from the lens as storytelling. And when we think about storytelling, we can also see that role-playing games redefined that art form. When we think about the evolution of storytelling, it starts in the cave. People tell each other stories, and this transformed into authors writing down their stories into books. We have plays, we have TV shows. What those two have in common is that we have a gap between the storyteller and the audience. When we start with role-playing games, that gap becomes more narrow. Sure, the first role-playing games, and still many role-playing games nowadays, have the distinction between the storyteller, or dungeon master, or game master, or however they call it, and the players, the audience. But all of them participate in storytelling, and with the last picture I wanted to show that some role-playing games take this gap completely out and say, no, everybody at the table is part of the story and everybody should have the same input. And then we have a real shared narrative where the storyteller and players become more or less one, and we redefine storytelling through this. And then I thought, but we're talking about art, so what could be art in role-playing games? When you look on internet forums, how people talk about role-playing games, and how they praise role-playing games, we can see more or less this list. We see that many people talk about art as in the artwork that is there. And some people talk about layout, some people talk about the lore text, the description of individual characters or the description of situations, of cultures, of whole planets, whatnot. Some people might even think about game design, and then there's a small minority to say, no, there's also art in game mechanics. Mostly we get comments like, oh, I love goblins, or hey, this book looks gorgeous. All of these comments are more on the upper side of the art, where we have pictures, where we have lore text. When we want to look for people talking about game mechanics or the game design itself, we have to look deeper into detailed reviews. And most of those reviews just give us a picture of what the mechanics do, but not why those mechanics are good. And those who are in my class, they already know I love mechanics because I feel mechanics are what make role-playing games really stand out. So thinking about game mechanics, I thought I'm going to shift the tone of this talk from talking about games to talk about myself a little bit and what I do with game mechanics. The first game that I created, Wude, is based on the five elements in East Asian philosophy and yin and yang. So you can see the dice in the games are black and white to represent both sides, yin and yang. We have the five elements on the sixth side of the six-sided die. We have qi, the element or the energy behind everything. And I tried to create this game with the idea of expressing philosophy through game mechanics. The inspiration to actually start creating was Lasers and Feelings by John Harper, an excellent game that some of you already know. It fits on one page, and it's a fantastic way of game design, layout, all the things that you could imagine. It has mechanics that let you play within 5 minutes. I use Lasers and Feelings in workshops to introduce role-playing games to teachers that might be interested in using role-playing games in their classrooms. And it's one of those things that I feel is a great tool, and that's why I wanted to become a game designer on the side. And then COVID. It's a black slide because during that time I was stuck overseas with my family. We were in one room and we couldn't come back home for over 10 months. And I wouldn't say I was depressed during that time, but I was not in a good place. I tried to find something for me to do, and I discovered game jams. The idea behind a game jam is that you have some sort of prompt, and creators from all over the world will create something to that prompt. That could be something simple like the word circle. And game designers would create a game that has something to do with circles. Or you could have a system reference document, an SRD, that somebody published and says, hey, try to make a game using that SRD. I want to see what you come up with. And the first game that I created was a bookmark journaling game for the novel Dune, because I was reading it at the time, and I tried to give the reader some sort of outlet. So you would read the novel, you would take that bookmark, and there are prompts on the bookmark based on one of the characters, and you would answer those prompts in a journal from the perspective of that character. Later I started to host my own game jams. The Five Powers jam is based on Wude, the Five Powers. I started to join other game jams. A really big one that I joined was the Lumen Jam, where I created a cleanup crew, a game that I crowdfunded successfully. Then I created some other things. Quixotic is an SRD that's 88 words. It's very short. It's a little bit silly. And over the time, I found out what I really, really enjoy, and that culminated in Rise. One of my latest ideas. And when we look at Rise, the idea here is not just playing characters, but experience the evolution of a character within a story. And I'm not talking about a campaign where you have multiple sessions and after a certain amount of time you level up or something like that. No, character development within a session during a 2 or 3 hour game. That's what I was interested in, and I came up with a 3-act structure that introduces the character, then it gives you the tools to experience the character, and in the 3rd act you will test your character and what they can do. That's me talking about my love of mechanics. But I also want to talk that I started looking at games in a different way. Not just the games of other people, but also the games that I produce. And here is a quote that a lot of hobby creators will recognize. I create for myself. And in the beginning, we mean it. And then we put ourselves on the internet out there and somebody says, hey, this is really good. And we start crowdfunding for a project and now it becomes work because now there's money involved and you try to get your game on a popular page. You try to have exposure with your game and all that turns into stress. I learned through that because I was caught in that circle as well where I tried to get my games hyped up. And I came back to the point, yeah, I create for myself, but now I actually mean it. It doesn't matter if my game's on the popular page or not, I still enjoy it, I'm still really, really excited. And it's amazing to see that people out there play my games and give me positive feedback on it, but that's not why I'm creating those games. I started looking at games as my personal whim-wham projects, more like art projects. And I wanted to highlight three of them where I started to explore with personal expression, with artistic expression in layout and also in design. The first one that you can see is a game that's inspired by Moby Dick, the novel Moby Dick. And you can see that it is cut in half. The top half is the whalers, who are trying to catch the whale, and the bottom half is the whale. And I decided this would be a fun way to express game design, to have that divide on the table physically. When you print out those papers and put them on the table, you can really see on which side of the story you are. The next game is Spare. The idea here is the whale attack happened, and you are the sole survivor on a boat and you try to survive in the middle of the ocean. There is this really dark page in the middle because you might do something unspeakable. I didn't define that because I wanted to keep that vague. But the idea here is that you go through emotions and you try to journal your thoughts from day to day as you are running out of rations and maybe have another survivor with you that you think about doing the unspeakable too. The next game is Loom. It's the same as the first video game that I ever bought in 1991. It's also called Loom and it had really, really simple mechanics, and looking back, I was fascinated with the game mechanics even back then. As an 11-year-old, so my love for mechanics is something that brought me a really, really long way. Loom uses a magic system that is built on toads, and you can't really see it well on the picture, but it is written on note paper, so it's not a lined paper, it's individual note papers, because the magic system is based on notes, and I wanted to capture that feeling in the game as well. And if we think about all those things together, the changes of storytelling, the changes how the industry is looking at role-playing games, the changes how I think about mechanics in a game, and the changes how I have my own personal perception of myself and the art that I create, I realize that I'm more interested in characters than in roles. Most of my games don't have roles, most of my games have characters. I'm interested in the development of these characters, not through certain points, but in a fluid development, and I'm interested in stories that change, and I wanted to create something that has a mechanical expression of this change within the story. And the first game that I actually created something with that in mind is Rise of the Apes. It's based on the movie, fantastic movie, Rise of the Planet of the Apes, and the mantra of the movie is apes together strong. And I wanted to capture that phrase, apes together strong, and I came up with this strength tracker. The idea is the stronger the group of apes becomes, the more mechanical benefits they get. They get extra dice when they roll for checks, but this also means they are a bigger threat to the humans around them because the humans are more afraid, and that will give narrative and later on some mechanical disadvantages to the players playing the game. In the same vein, I did another game based on Blade Runner 2049. Yes, a lot of my games are inspired by some other media. Here you play a replicant, someone who is bioengineered and is not allowed to have feelings based on human society. But they experience emotions at some point, and once they reach a certain point, it's not acceptable for human society anymore. So again, I have a track that tries to represent changes in the character, gives them mechanical benefits throughout the game, which changes how the game is played, and we have narrative difficulties that those players have to overcome. And with that, I want to finish this talk just by saying, art is what you do. Art is what you want to put in it. For me, art is game mechanics, and I find it fantastic what you can do with game mechanics and how you can express yourself through game mechanics. Thank you.